Hey, welcome back to Critical Thinking. In our last episode, we spent a good bit of time analyzing categorical propositions, introducing the different types, breaking them down into their constituent parts, and translating them into proper categorical form. In this episode, we're going to build on what we learned. We're going to start by looking at what types of claims we can infer from our knowledge of the truth or falsity of a proposition, and then we're going to see how we can transform a statement into a logically equivalent proposition, should the need arise. This is a skill that you're going to be really glad you have once you begin to analyze arguments. So let's take a look. Starting with the square of opposition and immediate inference, the first is a tool. The second, something we'll be able to make or draw with that tool. Now let's begin by taking out our opposition. That is the square of opposition. Let's actually take it out and, you know, take a look at it. Obviously, we have a square. And it might look like an ordinary square, but this is a special square, because we're going to use it to illustrate the various relationships that exist between the four types of categorical propositions. It might look a bit complicated at first, but the diagram is actually pretty simple. And if you memorize it, which is really easy to do, especially with its perfect balance and symmetry, something the ancient Greeks found to be the hallmark of true beauty, is going to make two tasks much less difficult. One, drawing immediate inferences from categorical propositions, and two, translating any categorical proposition into a logically equivalent proposition. But before we attempt either, let's take a closer look at the square and walk through the relationships. Notice the corners of the square. Each is occupied by one of the four types of categorical propositions. Left to right, top to bottom, we have A, E, I, and O. On the top are universals. At the base are particulars. So altitude differentiates quantity. On the left are affirmatives, on the right are negatives, each side distinguishing quality. Then we add the arrows representing the various relationships between each. Let's start with the contradictory, since the law of non-contradiction is an axiomatic starting point for all logic, as we know. There are two pairs of contradictories, A and O, E and I. And as contradictory, each member of a pair must have an opposite truth value. They cannot both be true and they cannot both be false. This means that if A is true, O must be false. And if A is false, O must be true. And the same is true for E and I. The truth of one proves or implies the falsity of the other, and the falsity of one implies the truth of the other. For example, if something is blue, it's not non-blue. If something is round, it's not non-round. If something is X, if you'll go ahead and fill in the blank, it's not non-X, at least at the same time and in the same way. If all dogs are mammals, then it's not the case that not all dogs are mammals, or that some dogs are not mammals. Also, note, when we talk relationship between proposition types, we're assuming each has the same subject and predicate terms. That's kind of important. Next, we have contraries. A and E are contrary to one another. And like contradictories, they can't both be true. If all pointy-eared crime fighters are operating in Gotham is true, it would have to be false that no pointy-eared crime fighters are operating in Gotham. But unlike contradictories, they can both be false. Maybe some are operating in Wakanda. With these, the truth of one implies the falsity of the other, but the falsity of one implies nothing at all. Another example of a contrary relationship might be one existing between any two belief systems, which we can think of as conjunctions of propositions. For a conjunction to be true, you might recall, each part of a conjunction would have to be true. If system one holds beliefs X and Y and Z, etc., we can say it's true if X, Y, and Z, etc. are all true. If system two holds beliefs X and Y and non-Z, it would include a false belief, and the conjunction would have to be false as a whole. But both systems, or all systems for that matter, could be false, and that each might include some false proposition. Of course, this may be an overly simplistic way of judging belief systems, and in many cases, not all, beliefs can be independently critiqued, revised, or abandoned. And since it's highly unlikely that any of us holds a completely consistent and truthful set of beliefs, we should always employ our critical thinking to reevaluate and weed out those false beliefs hidden in the mix. The subcontraries are located at the base of the square. I and O are subcontrary, and their relationship is the opposite of the contraries. They cannot both be false, but they can both be true. The falsity of one implies the truth of the other. So if it's false that some young wizards are not being hunted by the Dark Lord, then it must be true that some are. Yet the truth of one implies nothing of the other. So if we know it's true that some young wizards are being hunted by he who must not be named, we still have no idea if some aren't. He may be after Harry alone, or he may be after everyone. The fact that he's hunting some doesn't give enough information to know if he's not hunting others. Then on the flanks we have the alterns. Here again, there are two pairs. The affirmative, A and I, and the negative, E and O. On the top, we have the superalterns, A and E, the universals. Super means above. A is a superaltern of I, and E is a superaltern of O. On the bottom, we've got the subalterns, I and O, the particulars. Sub, of course, means below. I is the subaltern of A, and O is a subaltern of E. Now, the relationship known as subalternation or subimplication runs this way. We begin with our knowledge of the superaltern in order to determine the truth value of the subaltern. The truth of the upper, superaltern, implies the truth of the lower, subaltern. But the falsity of the upper implies nothing of the lower. For example, if it's true that all members of the Justice League are heroes, it would have to be true that any subset of the group would be heroes. But if it's not true that they're all heroes, all we would know is not all of them are heroes. Perhaps some are, perhaps none are. There's actually no way to tell. With superalternation or implication, we reason in the opposite direction. Here we start with our knowledge of the subaltern. If it's false, we can know something about the super. The falsity of the lower, subaltern, implies the falsity of the upper, superaltern. Unfortunately, the truth of the lower implies nothing of the upper. So if it's false that some Roman emperors were baseball fans, we know that no Roman emperors were baseball fans, and that it must therefore be false that all were baseball fans. But if it were true that some Roman emperors were Spanish, we wouldn't be able to tell if it was only some or if it were all. Both would be possible. Now, what we've just been doing is what we call immediate inference, drawing an inference from a single premise without the mediation, immediately, of any other premise. Using the square of opposition, we can make immediate deductions from categorical propositions. Knowing the truth value of one proposition, we can immediately judge the truth value of the other three types within certain limits. For example, given an A proposition, all dragons are extinct, and knowing it's true, by immediate inference, we can also know E, no dragons are extinct, must be false, since contraries cannot both be true. I, some dragons are extinct, must be true, by subalternation. And O, some dragons are not extinct, must be false, since it's the contradictory of A. Now, here's where we might reach some limits, where immediate implications can't be drawn. Say we have an E proposition, no boys are Kryptonian, and that's given as false. I, some boys are Kryptonian, must be true since it's contradictory. We can always infer the truth value of the contradictory, but then we might hit a wall. A, all boys are Kryptonian is unknown. As a contrary, it may still be false, even reasoning from I by superimplication, nothing can be known. And O, some boys are not Kryptonian, is unknown as well, since by subalternation, the falsity of the upper implies nothing of the lower. And as a matter of fact, you should notice that we can't really get to O from any other direction either. Just go ahead and try it. Sometimes immediate inference, or even the analysis of a categorical syllogism, as we'll see later, requires the transformation of a proposition into its logical equivalent. Two propositions are said to be logically equivalent if and only if they always have the same truth value and meaning. This is different from material implication, where two propositions always have the same truth value only. There are three types of manipulation we can perform: conversion, obversion, and contraposition. Any of the three will produce a new proposition that is the same as the original proposition. The new proposition produced is going to be logically equivalent, but it will not be the same statement. Remember, the proposition is not the statement, but the meaning of the statement. Each type of manipulation or transformation is an immediate inference in itself, but they can also be used with the square of opposition, all depending on what task we're trying to accomplish. When to use each is also determined by our goals and the arguments we're trying to analyze. I think you'll understand how useful this can be when we get to syllogisms, but for now, let's just learn what they are. Conversion occurs when the subject and predicate terms swap positions. This is the simplest transformation we can do. Only contradictories E and I, however, can be converted, so we're limited as to when such a move is permissible. For example, no A is B converts to no B is A, and some A is B converts to some B is A. Let's go ahead and test it. Let's say A is a human, B is a fish. No human is a fish converts to no fish is a human. The new statement is logically equivalent to the original, being the same proposition. If we try to convert one of the other types, A or O, we'll see the problem we run into. So let's take all A is B and swap the subject and predicate. We get all B is A. It's not logically equivalent to the original, and it's obvious when we plug in for A and B. Let's make A circles and B geometric figures. All circles are geometric figures does not mean the same thing as all geometric figures are circles, nor do they have the same truth value. The first is true, the second not so much. Next, we've got aversion, which requires two steps. One, we change the quality without changing the quantity, and two, we replace the predicate with its term complement. So what does that mean? Well, a term complement is that which is excluded from a term. So if the term is A, the term complement is non-A. The term dog excludes everything else, whatever is not a dog. So in short, we simply add a non to the term in question. The cool thing here is we can invert any type of proposition we want. A, E, I, O, it doesn't matter. It's all legal. Of course, whatever type of proposition we start with will be different from the type of proposition we end with, thanks to step one. An A obverts into an E and vice versa. An I obverts into an O and vice versa. So let's walk through an example. All real pizza is Italian. Step one, we change the quality from affirmative to negative. It becomes no real pizza is Italian. Obviously, we can't stop there. Step two, replace the predicate with its term complement. It becomes no real pizza is non-Italian. The obvert we end up with is a statement of a different type, but it's still logically equivalent to the original. Our last transformation is called contraposition, and it too requires two steps. Number one, we swap the subject and predicate terms just like a conversion, and step two, we then replace each with a term complement. And also like conversion, only two types of propositions can be contraposed, but here it's the other two, contradictories A and O. And if you care about terminology, the contraponent is the original proposition and the contrapositive is the resulting proposition. Let's walk through this one as well. Contraponent, some A is not B. Step one, we're going to switch to the subject and predicate. Becomes some B is not A. Step two, we replace each with a term complement, and that becomes some non-B is not non-A. That's the contrapositive. Now let's make some substitutions so we can see the equivalence more clearly. Let's say A stands for dessert and B stands for ice cream. Some dessert is not ice cream. Something like apple pie, perhaps. And that becomes some non-ice cream, like apple pie, is not non-dessert. Of course, now I just want apple pie and ice cream, so logic can be frustrating after all. All right, let's do one more where we have to both transform a proposition and use the square of opposition. Assuming there are things that are capable of reasoning to avoid the problem of what we call existential import, we're going to begin with the proposition, some non-humans are not incapable of reasoning, and ask, if this is false, what is the truth value of no humans are capable of reasoning? But you might ask, how can we know anything about humans when the only piece of information we have is about non-humans? Well, to get the terms we need, humans and things capable of reasoning, we can contrapose the original O. And we get, some things capable of reasoning are not human, which must be false because it's logically equivalent to the original. If the O is false, we know that the corresponding E, no things capable of reasoning are human, is false via superalternation, and this statement we can convert. No humans are things capable of reasoning. And this is the claim that we were after, so it must be false as well. And there are other paths by which you can get to the target statement, but they should all yield the same result. If it's false that some non-humans are capable of reasoning, then it's true that no non-humans are capable of reasoning. And if there are things capable of reasoning and they're not non-human, they must be human. Now, it's going to take some time to get used to that stuff. So the more you practice it, the more comfortable you're going to get converting, obverting, contraposing, and using the square of opposition. Next time, what we're going to do is we're going to shift and we're going to take a look at categorical syllogisms, something that we've been waiting for a long time. So until then, take care, and I'll see you in the next video.